Welcome to the Commentaries, a podcast series from TAN in which you'll learn how to read and understand history's greatest Catholic works from today's greatest Catholic scholars. In every series of the Commentaries, your expert host will be your personal guide to not just read the book, but to live the book, shining the light of its eternal truths into our modern darkness. Visit tancommentaries.com to get your copy of the book and to subscribe for access to all the great reading plans, new episodes, bonus content, and exclusive deals for listeners of the Commentaries.
Today is day 16, and we'll be covering chapter 9, part 2, in the TAN edition of the book, covering the life and karma of Little Flower. But before we jump into this timeless memoir and spiritual guide, let's begin with a short prayer composed by Saint Therese of Lisieux, entitled To the Holy Face. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, Amen. O adorable face of Jesus, sole beauty which ravishes my heart, vouchsafe to impress on my soul thy divine likeness, so that it may not be possible for thee to look at thy spouse without beholding thyself. O my beloved, for love of thee, I am content not to see here on earth the sweetness of thy glance, nor to feel the ineffable kiss of thy sacred lips. But I beg of thee to inflame me with thy love, so that it may consume me quickly, and that soon Therese of the Holy Face may behold thy glorious face in heaven. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, Amen. Last time we discussed the beginning of her mortal element of tuberculosis and her dark night of the soul, how she made four beautiful points and three analogies. Today we'll finish the Life in Carmel chapter, and we'll look at many things, including what's the secret of fraternal charity and how it is so important not to judge others. There was a discourse that she had on fraternal charity which Grace Therese valued most. And here's what she said. I have received countless graces this year, but the one I value most is the one of understanding the precept of charity in all its fullness. I had never fully understood before what our Lord meant when he said, the second commandment is like to the first, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And today, it's very hard to get caught up with the world or with church politics and to lose sight of fraternal charity, how to be kind to each other. Sometimes it's easy to judge the surface, but we don't really know the heart. And she continues this discourse on fraternal charity. Now Jesus made known to me his will at the Last Supper when he gave his apostles his new commandment. Love one another as I have loved you. I set to work to discover how Jesus had loved them. I found that he had not loved them for their natural qualities. So she makes a point of how important it is to love neighbor. If we don't love our neighbor, how can we love God? For she said this, Jesus was ready to die on the cross to make this possible saying, greater love than this no man hath than a man lay down his life for his friends. So it's about, I think she mentions this somewhere else in her memoirs, but charity is not so much about thinking and saying things, but it's about action. It's about what we do. So that's the secret of fraternal charity. To love as Jesus loved, to lay down his life for his friends. And she goes to the next level, and she speaks about what I would say, or what I would ask, what's the secret of fraternal charity? So listen carefully. Yet I know, my Jesus, that you never command the impossible. You know better than I do how frail and imperfect I am. You know perfectly well that I can never hope to love my sisters as you love them, unless you yourself love them in me. So, dear listeners, That last phrase is so important. It's just pivotal in this statement. Unless you yourself love them in me, and that you and yourself is capitalized. So that is Jesus Christ offering his sufferings to the Father. And it's through that suffering of Jesus Christ that we can love other people. We love the Christ that's in them. So that's the secret of fraternal charity, to see the Christ in other people. Now, dear listener, it is very important that we not judge others. So Therese also gives us a great example of how to keep peace when mocked and always making pure intentions. So listen to this. It's a little longer, four paragraphs. It was one day during recreation. The portress came to ask me to ask one of us to help her in some particular way. I was as eager as a child to do this work, and as it happened, I was chosen. Though I began to put away my needlework at once, I did so sufficiently slowly to give my neighbor a chance of folding hers first, because I knew she would be glad to take my place. The portress noticed that I was taking my time and said laughingly, "I did not think you would add this pearl to your crown. You were much too slow." The whole community was left with the impression that I had acted according to nature. I cannot tell you what I gained from this incident and how tolerant it made me. Praise is no longer an occasion of vanity. I have only to say to myself, if my little acts of virtue can be mistaken for imperfections, imperfections can just as easily be mistaken for virtue. And I say with Saint Paul, to me it is a very small thing to be judged by you or by man's day, but neither do I judge myself. He that judges me is the Lord. I too am judged by the Lord. I am judged by Jesus. I will never think uncharitably of anyone, so that he may judge me leniently, or rather, not at all. For he has said, "Judge not, and ye shall not be judged." So she touches on a very important part of our spiritual lives, for we should never judge other people. And one example is when we point fingers at others, if we put up our thumb, we're pointing at ourselves. And so the remedy is to seek humility, to consider all others greater than oneself. As St. Thomas says, we can do that. We can consider everyone greater than ourselves because of our hidden faults and their hidden virtues. Next, we read about three lines of how Therese found peace, which should also work for us, dear listener. I can say with St. John of the Cross, my house is entirely at peace. What a value that peace is. But we have to be willing to suffer and go through the different levels of the spiritual life to be in union with God. And then she continues, there was at that time a certain nun who managed to irritate me in everything she did. The devil had a part in it, for it was certainly he who made me see all her bad points. Not wishing to give way to natural antipathy, I reminded myself that sentiments of charity were not enough. They must first find expression, and I set myself to treat her as if I loved her best of all. So notice how I mentioned this just earlier. I reminded myself that sentiments of charity were not enough. So you see, we can't just wish the good. We must do them. And that's why she says next, they must find expression. And I set myself to treat her as if I loved her best of all. So listen to what she does next. I prayed for her whenever we met, and offered all her virtues and merits to God. What a beautiful maxim to do for someone that perturbs us the most. Notice, she prayed whenever they met, and she offered all her virtues and merits to God, because when we do that, we assume that they have merits, and sometimes it would be well for us to assume that their merits are hidden from themselves and from us, so we offer them to God. What an act of humility. And that's an example of finding peace. And then she continued, I prayed earnestly for the sister who had caused me such a struggle. But this was not enough for me. I tried to do everything I possibly could for her, and when tempted to answer her sharply, I hastened to give her a friendly smile and talk about something else, for as it says in the Imitation, it is better to leave everyone to his own way of thinking than to begin an argument. So that's so neat. Again, it is better to leave everyone to his own way of thinking than to begin an argument. Now, that's a lot of effort, but that's the life of perfection, and that can be found in convents that are having strict observance of the rule, because there's enough silence and there's enough prayer. The day is full in a beautiful way, not just doing any activity whatsoever, but having contemplation with God. So listen, dear listener, to the fruit of her charity. What was the fruit of her charity towards this irritating nun? She said to me one day, her face radiant, "What do you find so attractive in me? Whenever you meet, you give me such a gracious smile." What attracted me? It was Jesus hidden in the depths of her soul. Jesus who makes attractive even what is most bitter. Aha, beautiful. If everyone in the world did that, this would be the foretaste of heaven. But there are those people that are just mean and evil people, and this is our opportunity to love them nonetheless. And maybe God just wants someone to smile at them, and then that will change them forever. Finally, she gives the story of a spiritual victory. Note her last words in this quote, "Fruits of my victory." One morning, I came softly to our infirmary to put away the keys of the communion grill, for I was sacristan. I was secretly rejoicing at this chance to see you, and that is Mother Gonzaga. But one of the sisters was afraid I was going to wake you up, and in her zeal, tried to relieve me of the keys. I told her very politely that I was just as anxious as she was to make no noise, but that it was my duty to replace them. I know now that it would have been better if I had simply handed them over to her, but I did not think so at the time. I tried to push my way in spite of her opposition. Then it happened. The noise we were making awakened you, and everything was blamed on me. The sister made quite a speech, the burden of which was, it was Sister Therese of the Child Jesus who made all the noise. I simply longed to defend myself, but happily, I had a bright idea. I knew I would certainly lose my peace of mind if I tried to justify myself. I knew, too, that I was not virtuous enough to remain silent in the face of this accusation. There was only one way out. I must run away. No sooner thought than done, I fled. But my heart was beating so violently that I could not get very far, and I sat down on the stair to enjoy quietly the fruits of my victory. What a beautiful story. And we repeat again what she recorded a few paragraphs above from the Imitation. It is better to leave everyone to his own way of thinking than to begin an argument. So at the end of the day, dear souls, we do well to read of this beautiful spiritual classic because it teaches us the importance of the interior life, where if we have a true interior life, then we are moving towards having a constant conversation with God. And whenever we discern spirits, we know that the spirit of the world will bring timidity and laziness. The spirit of the devil will bring anxiety and fear. But the spirit of God will always bring peace. So imagine Therese, after having to run away from that scene, that she couldn't run far because her heart was beating, but she got far enough where she could sit down and recollect herself. So imagine us being like her, where we sat down. What a beautiful time, because then there's that silence where we can let God in. So she received the fruits of her victory. And so, listener, may we all have very many victories as we strive to enter the narrow gate which leads to heaven. And that brings us to the end of day 16 of our study of the story of the soul. Thank you so much for listening and joining me on your journey to grow deeper in your spiritual life. Next time, we'll be discussing chapter 2, in which the little flower speaks about fraternal correction some more and gives us a great insight how not to use our self-will. And she speaks about two weapons that are necessary in the mystical combat. Until then, God bless.
This has been an episode of The Commentaries, a podcast brought to you by Tan. To follow the show, study more of the greatest Catholic classics, and to support The Commentaries and other great free content from Tan, visit tancommentaries.com to subscribe and use coupon code COM25 to get 25% off your next order, including The Story of a Soul and countless more spiritual works to deepen your interior life and guide you to heaven.